Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship this morning as we gather for a service of the Word. Due to a technical issue this morning, we don't have the projection of the order of service. We've tried to make enough copies of the order of service that everybody can have one. But if you don't have one, you can use Divine Service Setting Number 4 out of the hymnal in front of you. And as a COVID precaution, we've not been using hymnals, but because they don't get used every day, and the COVID virus did not last that long on surfaces, feel free, if you don't have the order of worship in front of you, to use the hymnal, and I believe it begins on page 203, 203 of the hymnal. Today is the wrap-up of the season of the Epiphany. Epiphany is the season where Jesus is revealed to be the Savior, the God from heaven who has come in human flesh. And the transfiguration of Jesus at the top of a high mountain is one of the great epiphanies of this season. So we are at a high point, and then this Wednesday, for Ash Wednesday, we go right down into a season of repentance. So please join us, if you are able to, this Wednesday at 11 a.m. for the Ash Wednesday service, including the imposition of ashes on our foreheads. If you cannot make it here at 11 a.m., you can join us in Lockport at 6:30 p.m. At Trinity for the very same service.
And it'll be on YouTube.
Pardon me?
One of them will be on YouTube.
One of them will
They'll be on TV, too.
Oh, one of them will be broadcast, yes, as well. And also today is the 14th of February, and it is Valentine's Day, named after a relatively minor saint, so minor that there is no official biography of who Saint Valentine even was, but apparently he was a martyred saint of the church in the first couple of hundred years of the Christian church, who in some way advocated for couples who were not able to get married to be able to marry, but ran afoul of the Roman Empire and became Christian martyr. In our prayers this morning, we include, in addition to those listed in the bulletin, prayers for the mother of a friend of Lori and mine, who is 88 years old, has COVID, has been in and out of the ICU. Her name is Nancy Dahl. So let us stand as we begin our worship this morning to sing hymn 911, Lord, This Day We've Come to Worship. And it's verses 1, 3, and 5.
Thank you.
record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word and call upon him in prayer and in praise, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us,
forgive us our sins,
and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. In the voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshowed our adoption by grace. Mercifully make us co-heirs with the King in his glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. The Old Testament reading is from 2 Kings, beginning in chapter 2. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel, and the sons of the prophets were in Bethel. Came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he said, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." Elisha said to him, "Elisha, please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The sons of the prophets were at Jericho, drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." And Elijah said to him, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the sons of the prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his cloak and rolled it up and struck the water. And the water was parted to one side and to the other, so the two of them could go over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask what I shall do for you before I am taken from you." And Elisha said, "Please let there be a double portion of your spirit on me." And he said, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if you do not see me, it shall not be so." And as they still went on and talked, behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it, and he cried, my father, the chariots of Israel and his horsemen." And he saw him no more. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is reading from 2 Corinthians, beginning of chapter 3. "Since we have such a hope, we are very bold, not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not gaze into the at the outcome of what is being brought to an end. But their minds were hardened. For to this day, when they read the old covenant, that some veil remains unlifted, because only through Christ it is taken away. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image, from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. But we have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word, but by open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we sing the Alleluia hymn verse.
Hallelujah, 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 Hallelujah,
Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah and Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. For he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, This is my beloved Son, listen to him. And suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We speak together the words that confess our faith in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. There he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated as we sing hymn 537, Beautiful Savior, all four verses. Hymn 537. mercy and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The sermon reading for Transfiguration Sunday is the gospel, the story of that scene at the top of the high mountain. At the end of the American hockey team's gold medal victory way back in the 1980 Olympics, announcer Al Michaels blurted out the famous quotation, "Do you believe in miracles?" Well, I'm not sure that a few hockey wins qualifies as actual miracles, but as Christians, our answer to this question had better be, "Yes, I do." Because without the things that transcend our everyday perception of life, there really is nothing to believe in. We start with the miracle of Jesus' resurrection from the grave on Easter morning. Without that miracle, Jesus is just another rabbi, perhaps an enlightened philosopher, somebody who spread goodwill, but nothing out of the ordinary realm of life on this earth. And while on this earth, Jesus went from place to place, healing the diseases of the people, opening eyes that had been shut blind since birth, and even raising Lazarus, the widow's son from Nain, and Jairus' daughter from the dead. Those things were just plain miraculous. And we either believe they were God at work, or we don't. Then there was Jesus' own birth, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. And that tells us he was not just the boy from down the street who became a sensation. He is the gift of God in human flesh for the purpose of being our Savior from sin and death. And heaven itself is a miracle, because it's not something that we can explain. How it is that we would have souls that live beyond our mortal flesh, that just like we've come to expect, grow old, wither, and die, just like any other member of the animal kingdom does. And so on this Sunday of the Transfiguration of Jesus, it's time for us to just sit back and take in the sights and the sounds of the miraculous events that happened at the top of that high. And so we join Peter and James and John as they stand in awe of what they see and hear, because there's absolutely nothing else they can do. It's all about God clarifying the identity of Jesus. Jesus is the beloved Son of God, and therefore the God of Moses, the great lawgiver, the God of Elijah, the great prophet. And both of these men were long dead. Both of them had been central to great miracles themselves, as we learned this morning in the Old Testament reading and in the New Testament epistle. Moses, we know from the parting of the Red Sea, the receiving of God's Ten Commandments. Elijah, we know of his battle with the prophets of Baal and his own ascension into heaven in a fiery chariot. So into the realm of the supernatural we go, powered by a faith that comes not from our own hearts, but by the illumination of the Holy Spirit in our otherwise unbelieving hearts. This transfiguration of Jesus is an astonishing account. And it's got a lot of moving parts to it. There is Jesus up there radiating with divine glory. And then there are Moses and Elijah talking with Jesus about his own crucifixion. Then there's the cloud of God's glory and his voice that comes from out of the cloud. And there are treasures in each and every one of these things that the Holy Spirit puts before people of faith today. But we're not the first to consider just what was set before the disciples' eyes that day. First of all, they had to wrestle with what they had just experienced on the mountain peak. And then they had to figure out how were they going to communicate to us what it was like for them to be there. for the edification of our own faith, let's consider how it was for the disciples on the Mount of Transfiguration, and how Jesus was comforting them in the tribulation of this world. Because all of the glory of the Transfiguration is merely a prelude to the glory of the cross. Now, in the moment, in the confusion, in the excitement, the disciples were all for, well, let's build tents. But for what? To preserve some of Jesus' glory? To prolong this glorious experience? In truth, they did not know what they were saying. They had no idea that from here Jesus was en route to a bloody death on a cross. And yet they see Jesus in his full glory. They hear the conversation Jesus is having with Moses and Elijah, and they just want to keep that going. Peter wanted to stay right there on the mountain. He wanted to capture the glory with his tents. He wanted to keep Moses and Elijah here by making homes for them. But these were not butterflies they were chasing. They're not trophies to take home. In fact, Jesus was talking with Moses and with Elijah about his going to Jerusalem for the purpose of dying. His appointed time had come, but Peter simply could not process what all of that meant. We have this temptation to be just like Peter. We like the glory of God. We like the power of God, the strength of God, especially when we think it's going to make things go better for us. We really like the shining version of Jesus. We pray to him that we might have success in our careers and in our families. And we hope that if we keep him around in our lives, that it may go well with us and we may live long in the land. But in truth, what we really need is the bleeding Jesus. Suffering has to come first, and then glory, as Jesus preached to the disciples after his resurrection, to those two forlorn disciples on the road to Emmaus, when Jesus asked them the question, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? We need the forgiveness of our sins before we're ready to live in God's glory. Because by nature, we simply do not belong in God's glory. The disciples, having no frame of reference for anything of this glorious nature, reacted as any of us would do when we're placed on a stage we're not prepared for. There was fear covering their faces. And that's what God's untempered glory without a cross will do to us. And so God the Father speaks, and his voice speaks to rebuke Peter, who of course is brash enough that he will learn to get used to being rebuked by heavenly voices. Peter had his own idea about how everything should be, but the voice from the cloud scolds him and says, listen to Jesus. Particular. Listen to what Jesus had just told him the other day. The saying that Peter had rebuked to Jesus' own face, that Jesus must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. Well, this rebuke suddenly puts Peter, James, and John back into their right mind. They had been following Jesus, looking for greater and greater glory with each town they arrived in. But there was a good reason for God to put them in the position of fearing what they were in the midst of. Because the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. And it's also the first part of repentance. The disciples now realize that they, in fact, need more than glory from Jesus, as revealed in the Transfiguration. because this glory, impressive as it is, does not save them. Instead, it puts them into a humble frame of mind. And as much as we may wish for the glory train version of Jesus, we could never stand with God like that. We just carry too many sins upon us. We're truly most at home in the valley, down below the mountaintop, down where all of us are striving against one another, striving to make a living, striving for self-respect, striving to improve our place in line for earthly glory. But in too many ways, we've fallen flat on our faces, which means we have so many reasons now to fall on our faces in terror before the holy God who rules heaven and earth. And as they leave the mountain, though, there are these disciples. They're still standing with Jesus. Coming down from this mountain, they are unafraid, for the true glory of the cross lies ahead. Jesus touches the disciples, and he commands them to stand and to no longer be afraid. And in a moment, all of that transfiguration glory is gone. Moses and Elijah are gone. The cloud has disappeared. The brightness shining from the face of Jesus has gone. And this is all for their comfort. It is Jesus in his humility that saves us and comforts us. And so from this moment forward, Jesus sets his face to go to Jerusalem, where his true glory will be revealed in his death and in his resurrection. The glory of the Transfiguration clarifies for us who Jesus really is, because he is truly God in the flesh. We see his power, and like the disciples, we stand in awe, but the terrible humiliation of the cross is where Jesus' true glory will be shown, because there on that cross, he is our Savior. When he is lifted up high on the cross, we see his great love. And he does not abandon his suffering in order to restore himself to glory. His faithfulness will survive and will conquer the shame and the condemnation that he endures for us there on Calvary. Now we can look forward to sharing in Christ's glory. For his great love on the cross has purified us from sin that so terrorizes us before God's glory. The shame and the condemnation of our lowly sinful lives is completely absolved by Jesus' strength and his endurance. So we might think sometimes of the Transfiguration as being the high point of Jesus' ministry. But in truth, for Jesus, it's really only a vantage point from which Jesus can see very clearly where he's going. From the height of the Mount of Transfiguration, Jesus sees Jerusalem. And from the glory of the Transfiguration, Jesus sees the humiliation of his death on the cross. And from the splendor of that Transfiguration, Jesus sees all the sorrow yet to come. And in the midst of all of that sorrow, he sees you. And he commits himself to your forgiveness. Your salvation. Amen. Please stand if you are able as we sing hymn 783, Take My Life and Let It Be. We'll be singing verses 1, 5, and 6, hymn 783.
Take my life and let it be.
Heavenly Father, you revealed your glory in the transfiguration of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who dwelt among us in the flesh. Open our eyes of faith that we would see him continuing to dwell among us here in the divine service, and that we would faithfully listen to him as he forgives and preserves us at the font, at the pulpit, and at the altar. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy Father, by bringing Moses and Elijah to our Lord's transfiguration, you reveal to us that all the law and the prophets are fulfilled in him. Send your blessing upon the servants of your church, that their preaching and teaching would flow from the understanding that all Holy Scripture testifies to Christ and to his works for our eternal salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Father, from whom every fatherhood under heaven is named, support and bless every Christian home, that husbands and wives would be devoted to one another, and parents would pass on the faith to their children by word and deed. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty Father, you establish all authority on earth. Bless those entrusted with this responsibility, both here and abroad, that they would serve with integrity and honor and for the well-being of all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, graciously comfort and strengthen those who are sick, hospitalized, or enduring ongoing treatment. We pray especially for Lynn Ambrose and Dick Brown, for Amy Bullard, Kevin Grooming, Jen Bush, Connie Davis, Linda Elliott, Larry Fuller, Denise Jambroni, Dorothy Haas, Trevor Hollenbeck, Dick Hoop, Matthew Jackson, Don Meats, Emma, Todd Payne, Dick Redons, Norma Rabel, Tom Wohl, Nancy Smith, Joanne Wagner, Lois Wagner, and Nancy Dahl, that they would know your peace and receive healing and relief according to your gracious will. Be with those who are lonely, depressed, or mentally ill. Surround them with those who know your redeeming love and will mercifully care for them. Grant steadfastness to those near death, comfort to those who grieve, and the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to all your children. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, we gratefully remember on this day the glorious manifestation of your Son's divinity on the Mount of Transfiguration. Teach us to listen to Jesus and to ever fix our eyes on him and his innocent suffering and death for our forgiveness. Strengthen us to remain faithful through all trial, temptation, and persecution. Preserve us to the end, that we may depart this world believing in your beloved Son, with whom you are well pleased. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Verses 1, 2, and 3.